We've discussed them a little bit before, but we're going to go into a little more depth right now. So let's pray real quick. Father God, we thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we just ask that you open up the ears of our hearts, Father, and help us to understand these words, Father, that you are giving us this morning, Lord. Father, just go to the deepest, darkest depths of our heart, Father. Rip things out that don't belong there, Father. Take that sword, that double-edged sword, and cut all the way down. So, Father, we would just ask that you would take all the noise away from us, Father. All the things we might be thinking about. Father, you know, the sun's out, it's nice, but Father, right now we just need to focus on who you are. So, Father, we're just asking, Lord, that you would just keep our focus centered on your throne room. And Father, we thank you, love you, and praise you, Lord, in your precious name we pray, amen. So in Matthew 16, verse 5, it says this. When they went across the lake, the disciples forgot to take bread. Be careful, Jesus said to them. Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They discussed this among themselves and said, it is because we didn't bring any bread. See, this is how we think. We don't think in the depth of who Jesus Christ is in our lives. So here they are. Jesus is saying, look, do not fall folly to these things that the Sadducees and the Pharisees keep trying to get you to believe. We're going to talk about the Sadducees and the Pharisees in a minute. And because the disciples didn't think in depth, the first thing that comes out of their mind is, well, he's telling us this because we didn't bring any bread. And the bread they offer us may not be the right kind of bread. And so we have to kind of be careful of that. So don't eat any bread that the Pharisees or the Sadducees have. And see, that's the way we think today. We don't think in the depth of the realm of the Word of God. A lot of times we'll just say, well, you know, God says not to do that because, well, it's just the way it is. But there's a reason he says what he says. There's a reason that Jesus tells the parables that he says in the New Testament. And we have to go beyond that place where we think, well, it's just this. He doesn't really mean it. He's telling us a story so we can go, oh, all right. Don't eat the bread. But that's not it. First of all, he said the word yeast. Yeast is used to raise bread. Yeast was a bad thing back then to use. Right? And so Jesus wasn't referring to bread. He was referring to the things that they put into what they want to give you. Right? So let's keep reading real quick. Aware of the discussion, Jesus asked, you of little faith. Four words that seem to, when they are brought up to anybody, creates conflict. Because if I ask you where your faith is, I guarantee you, you're going to get angry at me. Because nobody wants their faith questioned. When Jesus questioned everybody's faith all the time. Where's your faith? Do you truly believe in the things that I am telling you? Where's your faith? Because a lot of times we'll say, oh yeah, yeah, we believe what he's saying, but we don't believe what he's saying. We'll honor a part of what he's saying, but we never honor all of what he is saying. And that's the problem. And so when Jesus goes, you of little faith, where is your faith? Pay attention to me now, just because that little boy just ran across the front. It's not a big deal. No reason for you to stop paying attention to what God's saying to you. Because you can't miss this. When Jesus was saying, ye of little faith, he was saying, do you understand what I'm saying? He wasn't questioning faith. He was questioning if the people there actually understood what he was telling them. In other words, do you believe the facts that I am telling you are correct? Let's keep reading. Why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? See? All of a sudden, we're not in that place of death. Well, we didn't bring bread, so don't eat the bread that they got, and da 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 da. And it's not what Jesus is talking about. Now, let me tell you something. The reason they didn't understand what Jesus was talking about is because they didn't understand who Jesus really was. They've already seen him 3 times. He's come back from the dead 3 times, and he's in front of them again, and he's telling them exactly what they need to be careful of, which is actually receiving what the Pharisees and the Sadducees have to say to them. It has nothing to do with bread or yeast. It has to do with living in the Pharisaical or Sadducaical laws that have been put forth by those two establishments. And I'm going to tell you about those two establishments in a minute. Because as I looked them all up, it was very, very interesting. Do you still not understand? I love that sentence. Dude, that's a series. I'm doing a series on that in a couple of months. Do you still not understand? Don't you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000? Here we go. You've seen what I've done. You've watched me do it, but you still don't get it. You still don't understand it. You watched me turn those loaves into many. You watched me turn those fishes into many. You watched me feed the multitude of people that showed up. But yet you still question my word when I speak it. See? It's pretty amazing. It's not about yeast. It's about trusting in him and what he says. See, the problem that we have today is we live in the same place as the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And like I said, in a second, I'm going to run down exactly what they were. You know, some of them believed and some of them didn't. Some of them bought some of it. Some of them bought a little of it. And that's with us today. Imagine what would happen if you turned your whole life over to Christ. Some of you just went, oh, geez, I can't do that. Your whole life held nothing back and just went gung-ho forward in his word. But I know some of you won't do that because some of you don't believe Christ is who he says he is. And I know some of you don't believe God has the power that he says he has. And I know some of you don't believe that you've been given the power that he has that he's given you. Are you happy with your lives right now? In where you're at? If you are, then you're satisfied with mediocrity. I didn't say it was going to be a fun-loving service today. I'm laying a foundation. Sometimes you got to dig roots up when you do a foundation. Sometimes you got to go down deep and chop at the root. And it's not with something dull, it's with something sharp. And right now, God is chopping at some roots. I should have come with an axe to that. Or a chainsaw. Not a butter knife. So don't you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? How is it you don't understand that I was not talking to you about bread? How do you understand that what I'm talking to you about has nothing to do with a loaf of bread? I love it when services end and people come up and go, how do you know? I don't, but God does. All things. And the only thing I'm doing is up here relaying a message from him. Because Wednesday night, all night long, we had a conversation. Listen, these words. Do you love me more than these? Fill in the blank at the end. Do you love me more than you love yourself and the pitiful life you're living in right now. Because if you do, I have something for you. And it's not bread. Matthew 16:5 is where we start.
The first one you said, you do love me more than yourself.
Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than these? But be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And then it was like a light going on. Bing! And then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast used in bread. Oh, duh. See, a light went on. Oh, wait a minute. He's not telling us about bread. He's not telling us this. But against the teachings of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Today there's a lot, and we talked about this last weekend. If you weren't here for last weekend's message, you need to go online, you need to go to YouTube, and you need to listen to last week's message. Because I'll tell you what, I took all the energy away from all the groups that think they are curing people and they're not. I took every single reason to give people pills away last Sunday. Because it's all due to a process of thought brought in by a root of evil that comes to a place where we begin to think. As a matter of fact, I have a young man that in this service 2 weeks ago, he called me up, confessed to alcoholism, been drinking for 5 years. He came to this service, he listened to a message, we prayed, and hey, Jason, and you know, pray for Jason, he just dealt with a bunch of little girls all night long. And so what happened? You know what? Miraculously, he was delivered from alcoholism in this chapel, in one of those red seats back there right in front of Kelly. I've been talking to him for 2 weeks, no urges, no nothing. He goes, I have been delivered.
Amen.
And he spoke to his wife, and she's like, he's different. He's different. Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than the things that the world tells you that you need to be? So what's the difference between a Pharisee and a Sadducee? As we embark on the next series, the Lord has asked me to be specific and clear that these two classes of people rule today. Now the Bible will tell you, if you look up in your history books, it will tell you that one of these groups of people is gone. That's a lie. Because they're alive and well today. And I'll prove that to you in a couple minutes. All right. Most think this was just a Jesus time thing, but they are very wrong. They are alive and well and living in churches across the world as we speak. As a matter of fact, we probably have some here today. Now don't freak out, I need you to listen and not become defensive, as the Lord may reveal something to you that you may have never known. Isn't that what the Word of God does? It reveals light on darkness. Because if we just sat in our houses, in our chairs, and went, there's nothing wrong with me, we would be believing lies from everywhere. Because we're pretty messed up. And we need God to cast the light of life onto the darkness in our lives so we can go, oh my Lord, what the heck is that? It's like when you find a big spider in the corner and the body's like this.
Yeah.
But when you pop it, it's all air. And it just goes, and that's it. Well, guess what? That is sin in your life. It's like a big pus-filled sore. See, I got your attention, didn't I? And when it pops, sin goes everywhere. But, see, if it's doctored correctly, it disappears, and it's gone. Right? So that's what Jesus does with his messages. He reveals the pus-filled sin in our lives so that he can take it away and clean it. Okay? Sometimes I have to use those vicious illustrations. But it wakes you up. So don't become defensive. If we look at the most of the Word of God, if we look in the Word of God, we see that there were two ruling parties. And they were always against Jesus. So let's stop there for a minute. Two ruling parties, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they were always against Jesus in some way, shape, or form. So we all have a little Sadducee and a little Pharisee living in us. And it's always against the Word of God in its completeness. Because, well, we love control. And heaven forbid we should give up control, and I'm going to say it again, of our pitiful little trivial lives. That I'm including myself in that. Heaven forbid we should give up control of that. Because, oh, we need to hold on to that. No, we don't. No, we don't. When I say hand it all over to God, I mean hand it all over to God. Because honestly, what have you done with it so far? Well, you know, I wake up in the morning, I'm worrying, I'm stressing out, I'm getting headaches, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, you know, I've constantly got to do this and that. When the Word of God tells me that the battle belongs to the Lord. Yes, I'm here. I'm in the midst of the battle. But the battle belongs to the Lord, not me. Our fight is not against flesh and blood. You need to understand that. Our fight is not against flesh and blood. It's against the principalities of darkness. So why do we hold on to this? Why do we constantly turn against God? Why do we listen and go, oh yeah, we'll sit here and we'll agree. Yeah, yeah, but the minute we walk out, we go, not going to happen. I'm not giving it all to him. I got to hold on to some of it. If I was hauling you behind a boat and you had no water skis on and you were holding on to a rope and you were sucking in gallons of water at a time, would you not let go? I hope so. Because you're going to drown and die. Well, it's the same thing with living in a realm of sin. You will die at some point in time. It will eat you up and it will floor you. And then you'll be on all sorts of medications trying to get rid of it. I can't chew enough Valiums. I can't chew enough stuff to keep my stomach from bleeding. I can't chew enough of this, enough of that. I can't take enough tranquilizers. I can't do enough this. I can't do enough that. When one whole answer is to get into this. I've said it before and I'll say it again. I run down the stairs in the morning to get to this. This is my lifeline. This is my lifeline. It's the only thing that will bring me peace. It's the only thing that will bring calmness. It's the only thing that brings life.
Amen.
So the Sadducees were the rich elite at that time. So as wealthy people, they became the ones that never wanted to upset the apple cart, so to say. You know why they never wanted to upset the apple cart? Because it wouldn't benefit them if they did, and they wouldn't be able to make the money that they loved so much. You see, they were in love with money. Romans, natural man, didn't want anything to do with God, so they became those people that were like, well, if boys want to use ladies' bathrooms and ladies want to use boys' bathrooms, that's okay with me. They were always in the middle. It's funny how there's still a lot of us that live in the middle. Is that a hard slap? There's still some of us that live in the middle. We have determined not to go here or there. As a matter of fact, middle is lukewarm, by the way. And the Bible tells me that I will spew you out of my mouth if you are lukewarm. I'd rather have you hot or cold. God has more respect for the person that is cold than he does for the person that is lukewarm. Why? Because they made a decision and now they're living in it. See the Sadducees. They were lukewarm. They made a decision to live lukewarm. So today, most of those people are in larger churches as we speak. Heaven forbid we should offend somebody and lose our offerings. And I have proof. I have proof. I've got writings from different people, a whole bunch of the stuff that actually confirm that. When you stop talking about the blood, and you stop talking about salvation, and you stop talking about redemption, and you stop talking about the three things that Christ thinks is important, then you have walked away and you have become lukewarm. There's probably at least 1,000 or more churches today that will never bring up the blood of Jesus Christ and why it was shed. They offer up peace by agreeing with everybody but never taking up the cause of Christ. Those are Sadducees. So, when we try to play the peacemaker and we take middle ground, we are living as a Sadducee. Because if you notice, there was no gray area. There's no gray area in the Word of God. There is no gray area in the Word of God. It is yea or amen. It is yea or nay. Most of the time, God says those things in the world are not good for us. And he tells us not to do them. He tells us we have authority over sin. But yet most of us, well, that's who I am. No, that's not who you are. And if you think you are, go back and listen to the last four messages on the, on listening to grace, on applying grace, on obeying grace. Go back and listen to those because you are not called to live in sin. You are called to be something more than those that went before you. Thus saith the Lord. So it may offend somebody and it may alter their way of life, and heaven forbid that should happen. Many times we are deceived by them as we think that they, because of their status, will take care of us, but the only thing that matters is them. The only thing that matters is them and their success and how they look and their status in life. That's a Sadducee. They're never happy. They're always sad. Honestly. Because they're not living the way they should. There is no joy in Mudville. So if you see somebody that's constantly sad, when the Word of God tells me that joy can be yours every single morning, then you are living as a Sadducee. Because you are sad, you see, because you're not living in the completeness and fullness of Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, you can tell a Sadducee because their knuckles drag on the ground. Oh. They believe that they set their destiny and that God has nothing to do with it. Oh. Remember last week we spoke about a great deceiving lie embedded in us at a young age, a neurological pathway of thinking. That they're in control, not God. Do you understand that if God really wanted to, he could unplug all of you right now and say, we're done. We're done. To me, that sounds like he's in control. Not quite sure with the rest of you. But to me, that means God at any given moment can go, we're done here. That means he controls everything. He created it. It's his. He can end it. Whenever he so pleases. But remember, we talk about a remnant. And the only reason he hasn't is because there are those faithful that consistently pray for his mercy to be bestowed upon us. You need to understand that. The Sadducee never speaks of the resurrection, because if they did, they would have to admit that Jesus was who he is and who he said he was. In their lifestyle, nobody gets saved. We all die. We all die and we go to the earth. That's it, done. There's no rewards. There's no benefits. We die, we're married, we look at a box. That's it. That's the thinking of a Sadducee. But, as I was sitting at my desk last night, God goes, also being a Sadducee, not believing in who I am, in what I've done, in what I will do. You see, Sadducees are easily deceived by humanity. And who runs humanity? The devil. The end of existence. No judgment, no rewards. We perish and the end is done. Here's the other thing. They have no belief in angels and demons or heaven and hell. It doesn't exist. If God doesn't exist, then his realm doesn't exist. So we just live like that. Nothing to look forward to. Nothing to have hope in. Just, I'm here, and I'm done, and I become fertilizer. That's it. That's what a Sadducee is. And they're alive and well today. We see them everywhere. They're embedded in churches all across the country, all across the world. You know? And they're great when they're used by the enemy, because you know what? They plant these seeds. And I was sitting at my desk going, God, why are you having me talk about these in this series? And he goes, because I want people to understand. I know who you are. Not me, God. God knows the heart of every single person. He knows who you are. You're not fooling. So there's no heaven or hell, it's all about them, they're very deceiving people. The only thing that mattered was the way they felt. As long as Jesus didn't bring unwanted attention to them, they were fine. And then here comes Jesus. But when Jesus started calling them out, they did everything in their power to destroy them. To destroy them. So they were supposedly destroyed after Rome destroyed Jerusalem. That's what the history books tell us. No. They're still alive. They're around. Because the enemy's not going to let them go. Because they thrive on this stuff. So when we talk about the blood, we talk about the resurrection, we talk about Jesus, it's like, oh, stop talking about that. When we say to give it all to Christ, the sting comes off of them. Because they don't understand how to do that. It's like this. Here you go. and walk away. And don't worry about it. But the Pharisees were different. They were the commoners. They were the blue-collar folks. And the Sadducees used the Pharisees to do their bidding. Yeah. Let's get the common folk that might not be too bright, the label they put on them, on those people, on the Pharisees. Let's put that label on them, and we'll use them because, well, they're more popular with the people. Deception is an amazing thing. You see, deception keeps us from loving those more than this. In all reality. Now here's what made them different. They believed in the written word and accepted that it was written by God. By God. The problem with that was they believed in the law. So of course when Christ came, it was in direct conflict with what they had been taught. Because you know, once Christ came, there was a new covenant. The law had been broken. It was now commandments. It was now grace. It was now mercy. The law created more sin than it was made to take care of. There wasn't enough animals on the world to kill, to have a blood offering. So Jesus said once and for all, Son, go do what I have to have you do. Go become that blood sacrifice. Become that once and for all, it is finished thing. And Jesus went, not a problem. I'm going. And down he went. Down he went. And he walked with us. And he called out every Pharisee and Sadducee. You see, they didn't live according to the word. Now, the word Pharisee comes from the word prusham, meaning separated. And in the Hebrew, the word Sadducee comes from the verbal form sadak, which means righteous. So I love this. So here we have the separated using the self-righteous to lead those to their end. Does that make sense? So we have those that are separated from God because they want nothing to do with God, using the self-righteous who think they're all right with God to lead everybody to their demise. Interesting how that works. All these people. And here's Jesus. He's the only one that's righteous among all of them. And they all want to kill him. They all want to kill him. So the separated who are in charge of the temple, that's interesting, who want nothing to do with God, are using the self-righteous who believe in the law of God to run the religious realm in that day. It's kind of interesting. It happens today. It happens today. Have you ever wondered why I never told you, why I always tell you I will never go on .com or use any other pastor to write a message for me? Because the separated tells the unrighteous or the self-righteous, and then they put it out on the internet. And then hundreds of pastors start preaching a separated message from the true life and light of Jesus Christ. That's why I will never use .com. I will never use message.com. I'll never use a canned message from anybody, ever. I want what God's thoughts are for me today.
Amen.
Because I will not allow a Sadducee yeast to ever be put in the bread that we're serving. What's the word? The bread of life. The bread of life. Do you love me more than these? Are you willing to say, I cannot live in that place? Are you willing to say, Lord, I love you more than I love myself? It's a very familiar scenario that is found today and in today's society. So I needed to kind of tell you, and like I said last night, I'm sitting there going, God, why are we talking about these guys? He said, I need you to lay the foundation. Because I need you to see what people will accept and what they won't accept. And I said, well, Lord, they have a hard time accepting you. And he goes, absolutely, but they'll accept the pharisaical and sadducical truths, which are all based on lies. Please turn with me to John 21. Now, there's a lot of people that would love to come here, and I've heard it from their mouths. The Pastor Margaret came from there. Why not? Because I'm afraid of what? That you may expose something in me that I don't want to know. Well, you already know it. You've just buried it well enough that you can't think about it. And when you don't think about it and deal with those things, then God can never do a work in you. It's the way it is. You've accepted bondage over freedom. Here's a guy that's been drinking for 5 years. And he goes, I don't like wearing this shackle. Can I lose it? I'm going to lose it right now. And we prayed. When we prayed, he could actually hear the clink of the chain falling off of him. He goes, what do I do now? I said, drink a lot of water. He goes, why? I said, flush it all out of your system. So when I met him shortly thereafter, I said, how much water are you drinking? It was like 4 days afterwards. He said, I don't know, about 25 gallons. He said, I've never peed so much in my life. I said, yeah, but how do you feel? He says, new. Any shakes, shimmies, or anything? None. He said, how are you dealing with your family? He says, I never got to deal with my family because I came home and went to bed. He says, I missed a lot. You see, here's this funny thing. When we allow ourselves to be held in bondage, we miss a lot. Mm-hmm. We miss a whole lot. Because God has amazing things. Amazing things for us. But we just need to give it all to Him. So in John 21, and I wanted to start at 15, but I'm not going to start at 15 because I want to start at 21:1. We'll get to 15 in a couple minutes. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. Now remember, Peter ran after he denied Christ and went back to, he went backwards. He went backwards. He went back to fishing. I hate going backwards. can't stand it. Because there's nothing backwards that I haven't already seen. I've seen it. I don't need to deal with it anymore. It's gone. Forward is where we need to go.
Amen.
Forward. If I was supposed to go backwards, God would have given me eyes in the back of my head. And I could just walk backwards everywhere I go. But he didn't. Notice everything we have in our bodies is pointed forward. Our ears are pointed a little forward. Our eyes go forward. Our mouths are in the front. Ain't no lips or nothing back here. Ain't no eyes back here. Yes, it makes some funny noises every now and then, but so does in this end. Gotta get rid of that mental picture now. So here they are, they're all on the boat. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. And they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got in the boat. But that night they caught nothing. Lord, you know, nobody asked. You ask not, you get not. Just, I'm going to fish. Because that's what he knew. Do you ever wonder why we keep going back into our sin nature? Because that's what we know. We find comfort in it. We find that's a, oh, this is great. I love this. It's like sitting in a wet diaper until it gets cold. Then it ain't fun anymore. So here they are, they're sitting in the white diaper, they're out in the boat, they're going, oh, this is, you know, good and fun, and this is great, and they're not catching any fish, so the diaper's becoming cold. I'm sure Evan, you know, when it's warm in his diaper, he's happy, but when it's cold, he don't like it no more, right, John? He tends to complain a little bit. All right. I can use Evan, because Evan lets you know when something's not right. All right. So here it's getting cold. They're not catching nothing. They're not catching nothing. We're not being blessed by God because we've gone backwards rather than forwards. Remember when I said during the offering, you know, when we're pressing down hard enough to crack rock when we're writing our check, and we wonder why we're not being blessed? Because we're not living in the heart after. We're living in the emotions of the world. And so all of a sudden, we're sitting there, and the disciples are sitting there, and yes, we're in that boat. We're in that boat. And they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. How many times has Jesus been standing there going,
hello, we're here.
And we're like, I mean, we even put the glasses on. And we stare out. And somebody goes, don't stare at the stranger. And it's really Jesus. But see, we are not looking through the eyes of Christ. When we look at Jesus. So here he is, he's standing on the shore, he's waving up and down, he's doing his Jesus thing. And he called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? In other words, friends, have you received the blessings that I could bestow upon you? No! Now, if I was Jesus, I would have said to him, why not? Because we know why not. Because we've been told how not to do things, and we choose to do them the way that we want to do them. Because there's a little bit of Sadducee living in us. And there's a little bit of Pharisee living in us. And what's a Sadducee? They want control. No, Jesus, I'm not going to do it that way because I know what I'm doing. And I'm sitting here all night and ain't got a fish. So Jesus goes, look, throw your net on the right side of the boat. In other words, do as I say and watch what happens. ye of little faith. You see, they had been sitting there all day and all night, and nothing had happened. And this stranger, they didn't even know it was Jesus, said, look, throw your nets over here. Remember, they didn't know this was Jesus yet. They had more faith in the stranger than they did in Jesus Christ. So they threw them over. We have more faith in the stranger that lives within us than we do in the Word of God. And that is sad. That is sad. We have more faith in a program than we do in the redeeming power of Jesus Christ. We have more faith in what somebody may say than what the Word of God has proven. Do you hear the word proven? We put our faith in everything but what we should. And so they threw their nets on that side of the boat, and they hauled in a large number of fish. Then they figured out who it was. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." And as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. What is it with Peter and water? I'll tell you what it is. Peter figured out who Jesus really was at that moment. And he could not wait to get to him. And so it didn't matter that there was water between him and Jesus. He was going for it. Because you see, since the last time Peter had learned how to swim. And Peter, can you imagine Peter? He puts on his robe. Remember the robe he took off. And he put it back on. And he jumped in. And he swam to shore. And I'll bet you Peter swam like there was no tomorrow. And I'll bet you when he swam, he never took his eyes off. The other disciples followed in the boat. They're like going, "Hey, dude, we just got all this fish. We're not leaving it here." They brought the blessing ashore. You see, they listened, they obeyed, and they were blessed. Towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals. There were fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. You notice how obedient he is right now. It was full of large fish, 153, but even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" Who are you? See, they knew who he was. How many times do we ask Jesus who he is? "Who are you?" When we know who he is. Because we've seen what he's done. Who are you? We know who he is. He's the Savior. He's the Lamb that was slain. He was the one who shed his blood for the remissions of our sins. What does it say, remission? It means put away. Never to be seen again. But yet we keep using these. "Well, I'm human. I'm human. I have a sin nature." I got in a really heated discussion with a pastor's son once. Because he kept telling me he knew the Word of God forward and backwards. But well, you missed a valuable verse. That sin has no reign over us. That we can have reign over sin. It doesn't say that. And then I whipped off all the verses. And then you need to go back and read your Bible. Because if I hear you use the excuse, I'm a sinner, and you are using God's grace to cover your sin, well, that makes you a Pharisee and a Sadducee. See, that makes sin a license to sin for you. That makes you lukewarm. So they got there, they're eating breakfast, they're kicking back, no eggs, just fish. They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" So Wednesday night, the Lord continued to say these words to me all night long. I asked him to let me sleep, and he said, "Do you love me?" over and over again. Oh, that's a tough one. I finally said yes, and he said, "Why? Why do you love me? Why do you love me?" And I said to him, and this was at 4:30, I said, "Because you saved my life, and you set me free." Why do you love Jesus? Why? And then he said, "I want you to do this series. I want you to teach them how to love. Because see, unless you're loving with your whole heart, your whole mind, and your whole soul, you're living as a Sadducee or a Pharisee. And the only way you can see the glory of God is when you give him." So here we are today starting this new series, Do You Love Me? Now again, the reason I spoke on the two parties earlier is this. They loved the figure of the Lord, but never deeply loved who the Lord was. Think about that real quick. They loved the figure of the Lord, but they never loved deeply who the Lord was. How many of us love the figure of the Lord, but we never love deep down exactly who he is? We're okay with him as long as he keeps his distance. But when he starts meddling in my affairs, some of you just woke up. Then we become angry. Well, I'll show him. I won't go to church for a month. He tells me that well. Well, I'll show him. I won't read his word. I'm not going to pray. Then we stand on our feet, do a little tantrum, hit the floor, walk away. It doesn't affect Jesus. As a matter of fact, this is what he does. He weeps. Two-word sentence. He weeps, and he lets us have our way because he's a gentleman, and he doesn't interfere. I'm almost done. They loved his law, but they never did find the favor by him. They never loved him, but loved what he stood for. We can't say that most of the time today. As I was looking in this, and the next thing it says, "Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said. "You know that I love you." Well, Jesus wasn't too sure. Because of the actions of Peter. It had nothing to do with the words. And that's what the Bible says. The actions speak louder than the words. So it's how we live in him. Not what we say about him. It's how we live in him. So as I'm looking at this, when it says, Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." All right, the word "feed" means zoon in the Hebrew. It's a noun, so it's an action word. So action means doing something. just going to go to church on Sunday, and that's all I'm going to do. I'm not going to talk to anybody. I'm not going to let my actions speak loud. I'm going to stay in the house, in my dark little room, and cower. It also means raha, primitive root. So as I looked up this word, it floored me when I saw the definitions of the root word of action. It means to tend, to teach, to feed, to associate with, as a friend, to be a companion, and be a keeper. So when Jesus was asking Simon, do you love me more than these? He was asking a pertinent question that we must ask ourselves today. Do we love these more than this? In the Assyrian, it means a child that is a new Christian. So Jesus is saying, Simon, will you take care of the youngest of those that seek me and not leave them hanging? 1 John 5:3 tells me, for this is the love of God. Ready for this? That we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. Some of you in your heads are going, Pastor Mark! Look at that, I just did that again. And you're stomping your feet in your head. I can't do that. No, it's that you don't want to do that. Because it's all about you. It's not about him. Because if it was about him, you would go, yeah, I can do that. What was Jesus telling Simon? No, wait, what was Jesus commanding Simon to do? Take care of those that come seeking me. Never turn them away. Never miss an opportunity to reveal who I am to them. Feed my lambs. Today, we need to seek the lambs. We need to feed those that are looking for the answer. This takes a love that is like no other love you have ever experienced before. God's going to bring you to a deeper love through these messages in this series. You thought you knew how to love. I thought I knew how to love one day, too. And then through these verses, Jesus showed me how to have a supernaturally deeper love than I've ever experienced before. You need to understand. You may know love, but you don't know love. But Jesus is going to teach you how to love so deep that it is going to hurt. But that's good. Because when we redevelop a neurological pathway in our brain, a new way of thinking, pain comes with it. Pain comes with that. And in that pain, I'll tell you what, we learn some amazing things. A supernatural love that can only come from a residential placement of Christ in the very depths of the heart of the believer. I'm going to tell you, this series is going to bring you to a new level of love with Jesus Christ and with people. It's going to make you look so deep inside that you're going to wonder how you came as far as you came in this. Because God's love is unconditional. And we're going to take you to a new level of set of messages. Do you love me more than these? Because you love way too much more than God. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father God, we come before you, Lord Jesus. One of the first steps in loving is receiving. And the first thing to do in receiving is to come before Jesus and say, Lord, forgive me. I'm a sinner. You paid the ultimate price for me, Father. Can you forgive me, Father, and come into my heart and save me? You only have to do it once. You only have to receive Jesus Christ once in your lifetime. If there's anybody here that has never received Jesus Christ, this is the prayer. I prayed it many years ago. Father God, forgive me for my sins. Come into my heart, Father. Redeem my heart. Make me a new creature, Father. And take up residence within me. Save me, Father. Save me. Simple prayer. Simple prayer. So if there's anybody in here that's never said that prayer before, and this is your first time, then all I want you to do real quick is just raise up your hand. If you said that prayer, thank you, Father. Thank you. It's that simple. Father, come into my heart, save me. I want your life. Father, you know where we are all at right now, Father. We are in the place, there's so many different levels of love that many of us are at right now, Father. And Lord, I know that this series is just going to bring us to a place, Father, that is going to do some amazing things in our lives. Yes, Lord, we love you more than these. So, Father, I just ask, Lord, Father, that you would just bless those, Father, that do not know that love. Father, go way, way down, deep. Cut those things out that are keeping us from experiencing that. So, Father, I just thank you, love you, and praise you, Father. Just bless this message. Bring it into our minds and our hearts and our souls all week long. Do not let the deceivers in to ruin this. Do not let our Sadducidical or Pharisaical beliefs convince us that this is anything but you. So, Father, we thank you, love you, and praise you, Lord, in your precious name, we pray, Father. And all God's people said,
Amen.
You are dismissed.